It was in the heavily forested province of Kaffa that the team first took in the sights and sounds of rural Ethiopia. They'd reached the little town of Bonga in the heart of the province, 260 miles southwest of Addis Ababa, where the economy has to rely on rudimentary local industry and very basic farming methods. Using local materials, the community was restoring its Orthodox church, as well as the original version alongside it, erected in 1898. Heavy and seasonal rain had drenched much of Ethiopia and other African countries, adding to the daily toil that is life for women in rural areas. And thick, clawing mud was to be a feature of the three-week expedition. But the night's rain tended to clear during the mornings, so the party of 17, with their four land cruisers, were usually able to enjoy a wayside snack on the sunny side of the street. Colonel John Blashford Snell was leading the team, and at Jimma, as they posed on the monument for a group photograph, everyone was quite excited about what may lie ahead. Nikki, a zoologist, took to the lion, of course. But little did Karen, Caroline and Ed realize the late nights and early mornings they'd have assisting her collect bats. Karen had previously visited Guyana with John, and Dr. Ed Barnes had accompanied him to Magdala in northern Ethiopia the year before. Janet and June had met each other in Kenya, a chance for them to experience yet another African country. And Malcolm would rise to the occasion daily with his erection of bat nets. Very early on, Janet and Trevor began making local contacts.
Only in Michael's day, they would do that one.
So how many St. Michael's days?
The expedition's main scientific aim was to study the bat population. Catching them became a crucial feature of everyone's routine, and the expertise of Omar from Addis University was to prove invaluable. Downtown Jimma, the team had been told about the many historic and traditional artifacts to be found in the museum here. Boule, the curator, was a mine of historical detail describing the costumes, artwork, traditional furniture and jewelry on display.
Since the women used to decorate themselves, it is it's from different kinds of things made up. It's from, there are iron plates here. It's from
the prize exhibit was this.
Haile Selassie, when he visited Jimma in 1865.
Musical instruments have been fashioned from unusual material, a tortoiseshell, and even umbrella spokes. King Abba Jifar II reigned over the Kaffa Kingdom from 1878 for 54 years and built his hilltop palace just outside the town. It's been carefully restored by local craftsmen, and while Boule described the mud, stone and wood building, a traditional delicacy was cooked in the team's honour. From the palace balcony, views over the surrounding countryside were breathtaking. A mother and daughter in traditional costume prepared an elaborate ceremony. For the drinking of coffee in Ethiopia is something of a ritual. They lay grass under the cups to introduce exotic fragrances and burn incense to enhance the atmosphere. The green coffee beans are roasted over a charcoal brazier And after water's added, the drink served at the end of a traditional meal of injera wat. The wat's a kind of spicy meat, the injera, a fermented pancake-like bread baked from local maize. Even in the remotest areas of this fascinating country, you'll find little bands of commuters on their way to work, in the fields or at school, leaving the traditional tukuls, their round houses, seemingly deserted, though somewhat more sophisticated than the first camp at nearby Dembira. Here it had rained all night, but no matter what the privations, Chef Hassin always managed to conjure up the most tasty meals. Whilst there's always mutual fascination between strangers and more permanent residents, one member of the team's overriding interest lay in the habits of some other local inhabitants.
We're undertaking a bat survey in conjunction with the University of Addis Ababa, and their scientist is lecturer Omar Nur Hussain.
I'm from Addis Ababa University. Presently I'm a lecturer there, and my interest is mainly to study the mammalian biodiversity in Ethiopia.
Ethiopia is a particular place to come to for me because I've just completed my PhD on African and Asian horseshoe bats, of which there are a number in this region of Ethiopia. We caught one last night, hopefully going to catch some more this evening, and we'll be able to show you some later.
Currently we are in southwest Ethiopia, and we are surveying the bat fauna of a thick forested area. We are particularly interested in the bats here to see if they have more in common with bats from Central Africa or from northeast Ethiopia.
Operation Bat Catch began early one evening when Paul and Nikki led a group of helpers to a nearby river. The neighbourhood children looked on amazed, probably thinking the team was bats too. The plan was to trap the little creatures in two nets as they flew out of this culvert at night to forage for insects, especially mosquitoes. The experts knew that just one bat can devour as many as 5,000 of them in one nocturnal outing. That's why, in areas where malaria is rife, detailed knowledge of the bat population is so important. But just as the traps were set, ominous storm clouds threatened a downpour, and that could ruin the entire operation.
Some of those were caught in the...
Much to everyone's relief, it didn't. The nets withstood the downpour, and the night's haul was impressive.
Two nets, and we got eight fruit bats, some which we collected last night in the dark, and some which we collected at dawn this morning. But this one's ticks.
Sorry.
Would live on this species only. They wouldn't even live on something that looks as similar as that. And one way of identifying the bat is to identify the ticks.
Tails.
They've all got tails, haven't they? Some fruit bats don't have tails, but these three species that we got this morning all have tails. We think we've got the Egyptian fruit bat. This is the mountain fruit bat. And we've also got the Angolan fruit bat. And there are other characters to distinguish them. But just look at the difference in body mass and in the size of the face. So like superficially last night, we thought we just got one set of species. But here you can see obviously we've got two. We're not absolutely certain what this one is at the moment, though we think this one's Angolan. And also look at the size of the feet and the size of the wings. This is an enormous fruit bat. This is a fruit bat. Our fifth species of fruit bat, we think it's the Egyptian fruit bat. It's actually a subadult, it's not fully grown, and it's a bit angry. To date we've got about 40 specimens of 11 species.
This is very good, especially considering the difficult conditions we've had with a lot of rain at night. Rain, of course, makes it extremely difficult to catch bats, both because it discourages the bats coming out and also it makes the nets easier for them to detect. Just take one photograph. Just keep still, my friend.
And what will happen is, as the fruits come into come ripe all around the forest, it will just fly from one and feed on different fruiting trees per season.
If you look at insect-eating bats, they have very small eyes because they don't really use them. If you look at this chap, he's got very large eyes because he's reliant on it to navigate around the forest. But he actually finds his fruit by smell. That's why he's got those tubular nostrils.
For videographer Lorna McGregor, the highlight of the whole trip was here. Alone at dawn on the shores of Lake Tchamo, surrounded by the strident calls of fish eagles, recording the sights and sounds of an unforgettable collage of all that is Africa. This is the stuff everlasting memories are made of. Even the plodding gawkiness of the marabou stalks couldn't detract from the experience, but something else was about to change everyone's plans. The Hamaso River Falls were dramatic evidence of the heavy rains which had swamped much of the southwest. While mud-filled torrents caused widespread disruption, life on the Garaji Plateau was a little more peaceful as the local cavalry teased a young mother. Ethiopia has a very rich tradition of music and singing, and the young here learn quite early to be part of it. The strains of his impromptu recital were a continuing tuneful backdrop at a brief stopover. The music drifted to the fields as villagers toiled in the midday sun, harvesting teff, a maize grown not just for food, but as a building material for their tuckles, the little round houses which dot the rural landscape. While some were not quite as rushed off their feet, others took it lying down. And if drivers assay found it hot work, what about the local backpackers, those ever-burdened women, of course, pumping the day's fuel stocks? They still use horses a great deal in isolated areas right across the country. Up here, some 10,000 feet above sea level, mules and donkeys too provide the local freight transport service. There's little for the young to do in remote places like this. For children as well as adults, life is pretty static in a country where massive unemployment is, sadly, a continuing aspect of the daily routine. Consumer goods are somewhat thin on the shelves, so the sight of an ancient set of scales here came as no surprise. While young hands may have spilt the beans, as their elders serenely swapped all the latest local gossip, at the school, pupils and staff did have something to be quite excited about. Here at Dinshu, just as at Jimma, the team had gone there to distribute much-needed books. And if there was just a little shyness about it all, it was soon overtaken by happy expectation and not a little impatience as teachers examined the contents.
The wildlife club prospers and the school does well. Could you write the headmaster's name and the school and the address and everything?
You mean both of them or the school?
No, the headmaster, because then we can...
A photo call, whether for school or family album back home, recorded just how appreciated the gifts were. Free education is compulsory for 7 to 13-year-olds, but a chronic shortage of teachers means only some 60% of the population is fully literate. The 250 students at this secondary school have to be taught in two shifts, so it came as a pleasant surprise when the team found a pair of shy twins who spoke a little English. But searing poverty is endemic here. A third of the population earns a mere £50 a year, and the tragic fact is that this infant faces a life expectancy of just 49 years. With so much deprivation, the children are easy to please. The gift of a single skipping rope, a rounder's bat and a football was enough to prompt this chorus of gratitude. Despite widespread hardship, the sound of happy voices echoes over much of the countryside. Though heavily burdened, some girls were cheerfully singing long before they came into view. It was at the Rift Valley that reports came in of bad weather ahead. But undaunted, the team pressed on southwards under very ominous-looking skies. Torrential rains had made a crossing point of the River Hamasi near Sodo possible for a time by only the largest of vehicles. But the enforced delay did have its moments. Eventually, the land cruisers battled the waters and made it to the little town of Chencha, where it was market day. Buying or selling there, you have to watch your back for those who pick a pocket or two. Malcolm, who towered head and shoulders above the locals, recorded his impressions for posterity. The Dorze people are renowned for the way they weave locally grown cotton into beautiful shawls called shamas. They're worn by men and women alike, but you may not actually have to buy one to be urged to part with your money.
Give to me dollar.
Judging by his headgear, maybe this colourful old character had fought their Italian invaders in World War II. By a uniquely shaped Dorze house, a 22-year-old mother of seven made vociferous demands for a higher entrance fee to her home. Not everyone wanted to listen, though. There was no such trouble at mill, however, where they weave very fine cotton on primitive traditional looms. Though they may have to toe the line to gain power, even newcomers soon pick up the threads. It's very intricate, painstaking and delicate work with a great deal of repetitive manual labour. The gossamer-like swathes which come off the assembly line have a particular charm. They even spin the slender threads here for the weavers, often under the rapt gaze of those who one day may be aspiring apprentices. High above Lake Chamo's many islands, the storm clouds were gathering yet again. Not surprisingly, camp life is often somewhat basic, even when all the facilities are in the grounds. But Hussein was always able to prepare five-star meals like this one of Nile perch.
Sounds lovely.
Thank you, madame. Today's different soup.
Wonderful.
I think.
Whatever you do is.
While Jifar kept things simmering nicely, another entree was on the way. Hardly served with elegance, but then the rather special diners didn't seem to mind. As for their parents, well, what a lot of layabouts they were. It was in this area that the bat team had been quite successful, but that night it would rain heavily and their luck run out. Disappointingly, there'd be no more bats this trip. The unscheduled extra came via an enforced diversion up to the Bali mountain range. Although strong winds lash the landscape constantly, it's an area teeming with flora and fauna. There are even protected species, among them the endangered, yet still elusive, Ethiopian wolf, and there are fewer than 400 of them left in the whole of Ethiopia. So finding this one so welcoming was a rarity. But he didn't hang around for long. Reed buck abound here, especially in the watery marshlands of the park's Geyse section, not far from the lodge. Proud Nyala females can get quite indignant over the presence of intruders, even if they can hardly be said to be close by. Menelik bushbuck are appealing in pose as always, and very graceful in movement. A stark contrast to those bullish and aggressive looking warthogs. The animals don't seem to mind the altitude. Perhaps it's the incredible stillness of the vast open spaces. And life higher up has to cope with temperature contrasts of 40 degrees Celsius between night and day. Male Nyala stand like monarchs of the glen when protecting their females and young. In fact, mountain Nyala were the last large mammal species to be named some 70 years ago. A Swedish-built lodge affords trekkers a chance to relax in more conventional style. To wash and brush up. To bring those diaries up to date. Or simply flop down and contemplate nature before journeying to a more desolate, gale-swept location. The Seneti Plateau, 4 hours from the lodge. No lush greenery here. At 13,000 feet, just a rock-strewn lunar landscape with occasional outcrops of vegetation and that never-ending wind. Yet in that bleak and barren wasteland, you may catch sight of the occasional Ethiopian wolf, if you're lucky. They seem quite at home patrolling the place, with the only cover afforded by an occasional giant lobelia and the odd tall cactus for a somewhat prickly convenience. Wattle stalks are unperturbed by visitors, and auger buzzards find the tops of those giant swaying lobelias perfect lookout posts. Further down the mountain, local transport's the quadruped kind, but for hardy aroma tradesmen, the horse is the only vehicle for crossing such rugged terrain. What looks like a clump of outsized green egg boxes is in fact a hotel in the east of the Rift Valley.
And this is your tukul, is it?
Its landscape gardens house a variety of trees and colourful birds, and a river whose banks sustain some determined foragers. This was the last occasion where the bat hall could be augmented, but the quarry stayed at home and the nets stayed empty. So, for the zoologist, had the expedition been worthwhile?
What we've learned is that bats don't seem to live at high elevation. We thought places like Wondergennet, where we are now, thick forest, there would be quite a lot of bats, but bat activity is very, very low. And this is one of the things we've learnt during this trip.
So it drops down very cold at night.
Yeah,
and so the insects just aren't there.
And where there's no insects, there aren't any bats, unfortunately. We have been in areas nobody else has been in. We've added information about Ethiopia's bats, and I think when we add it together with what's already known, it will be quite an important findings.
It's an ideal place to relax. While the hornbills sing in the trees, you can exchange notes of a different kind. Not quite breakfast at Tiffany's, but for the team, the first formal breakfast in days, and no one's blushes were spared.
You say something, Ed, because you've been particularly unkind. Your turn. We caught him in his socks yesterday.
Yeah, just his socks.
He doesn't like his socks.
Very British.
He's gone.
Oh, he's there.
Exactly. Has he anything or not?
An occasion where, for once, Lorna's face was not concealed by a camera, but directing habits die hard. Long days of bouncing around in land cruisers and nights under canvas were over. The expedition's aim hadn't been just about gathering information, it had been equally about giving knowledge through the books to help countless deprived children. Back in Addis, John Blashford Snell saw that as one of its most worthwhile achievements.
So this has been one way of actually helping the schools where people are struggling to get hold of books to learn English and learn about everything. But the medical supplies that Visho very kindly helped us to buy are going to be given to clinics, particularly in the areas struck by malaria. Malaria is pretty bad in Ethiopia, and we're very grateful to Visho for enabling us to buy these drugs in Britain. And Dr. Ed Barnes has brought them out here, and they're going to be used to help alleviate the suffering of malaria in some of the areas that we visited.
The 20-day tour across 2,000 miles of Ethiopia was over. Farewells completed, the group was taking back not just a great deal of detailed information, which would eventually help the country, but also many indelible memories of a kind and cheerful people in a wild and beautiful land.